Pleasant good night to each and every one of you. I greet you tonight in the powerful and the precious name of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we are truly thankful unto God for his goodness, his love, his compassion, his mercy towards us. And we pray that God will continue to bless each and every one of us tonight. I want to thank you for joining us tonight. I want to say a special thanks to Brother Rodney, who is my number one supporter. And, he's always been there for the streams and always been an encouragement to me. So thank you, Brother Rodney. I really, really do appreciate it. And thanks to all of you again who, are making things happen. Thanks to Sister Sabrina, who is championing the cause of prayer, and Sister Suzanne, Patsy, and Brother Rishi, and the names are so numerous to call. So if I didn't mention your name tonight, I did not ignore you. It's just that I fell in that trap of trying to identify people, but there are so many people who are working together and working in the kingdom of God, and a lot of times they are not recognized and they are not known, and I just wanted to take a moment to recognize those who are holding the fort, and who are the stalwarts in prayer. Whenever there's a need and that need is put out, people rally around and they pray, and I really cherish that. So thank you all, and I pray that God will continue to bless and minister to each and every one of you. Tonight we want to begin. I want to look to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll get straight into the worship. Father and God, we do thank you for your bountiful blessings and for all that you have done. Thank you, O God, for all that you will continue to do, O Lord, and I pray that you will grant us wisdom and understanding. I pray that you will help us, dear Father, that, Lord, as we study your word tonight, that, Lord, your Holy Spirit will illuminate our hearts and minds, and that we will receive not just head knowledge, but, Lord, we will receive from your hand, and we will receive the spirit of your word. Father, even as we worship you, O God, may it not be lip service, O Father, but as your word says, they that worship you must worship in spirit and in truth. And I pray, Father, that our worship and adoration, Lord, will flow out of a grateful heart and a thankful heart, and will flow out of gratitude, O God, as we remember, Lord, where you have brought us from. And as we remember, O God, the many things that you have done for us, in us, and through us, O Lord, I pray, O God, that you will continue to bless your people, their Father, and may our worship ascend unto you as a sweet fragrance. Have your way tonight, O God, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, I even pray, O God, for those that are sick, O God, those that are afflicted in some way. Lord, I ask that you remember Sister Nana and Brother Gaia, Brother Charles. Lord, that you remember, O God, Sister Gina, Sister Vashti and her family, Brother Rodney and his family, O God, remember them. Lord, remember Anthony and Deandra, O God. O Father, and I pray, O God, that you will touch them and help them, Lord. Remember Amanda and her family, O God. Lord, I pray, O God, that you will touch Sister Savitri and Brother Fado and their family, Father, that, Lord, that you will, O God, lift them, O God, and strengthen them, Lord. Remember Rishi and Sophia, his family, O Lord, as they continue to work, Lord, in the Sunday school, and, Lord, also in the prayer meeting and Bible study. Lord, I pray that you will continue to bless them and use them mightily, Father. Use them for your glory and for your honor, O Lord God. I ask that you have your way. Lord, Father, I ask, O God, your bountiful blessings. Lord, and even those that are that ailing in some way, and I did not mention their names, God, but you know them, O Lord. You know each and every one of them, Father. And I ask, O God, that you heal and deliver and set them free in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, let's go right into worship tonight as we join with the worshipers and sing and make a joyful noise to the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. Amen.
For your goodness and for your kindness. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Holy Spirit, fill this place as we worship. Just worship this morning. Worship. Hallelujah. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my I
welcome back. And, you know, I want to invite you at this time to text or call somebody and let them know that we are on. Invite them to join so that we can all share in the blessings together. Amen. Praise the Lord. Okay, so last week I started talking about, you know, what we call the rapture. Now we are still talking about the blessings of being in Christ. And one of the blessings that I focus on last week is that there is not only blessings here on the earth, but there is blessings hereafter. And I spoke of the rapture. And though the word rapture is not found in the scripture, what we refer to as the rapture is what the Bible calls the catching away of the saints. And I cited a couple of scriptures in 1 Thessalonians and in Titus, you know, and we looked at the fact that the Bible tells us, and even in Acts, where the angel said to them, you know, why are you standing here gazing? Because the same Jesus taken up from you will come back in like manner. And so on. So these scriptures that I shared with you, you know, do show for a fact and indicate for a fact that Jesus left and he's coming again. And, you know, we cannot lose sight of that. I also made reference of a parable that Jesus gave of the bride and the groom, and the five foolish and five wise virgins. And that in that parable, the foolish virgins referred to those who were careless and were not ready, whatever spin you want to put on it, but they were not ready to go with the bridegroom. But the five wise virgins were those who were ready. They were anticipating the coming of the bridegroom, you know, and they did not sleep, but they stood up, they watched and they waited so that when he came. Now, the interesting thing in that is that when the bridegroom came, he didn't bother to wake those up who were asleep. He left them, let them sleep. But those who were ready went. And it's the same way with the rapture. When Christ comes, he's not going to come now trying to gather people. He is coming for those that are ready. And so it is imperative that we be ready. Jesus, in his teachings, he said, you know, to watch. Be watchful, because he comes as a thief in the night, meaning he comes at an hour that you don't know and you don't expect. And that's why you got to be ready. And I want to send out this to all Christians, all non-Christians. I want to send out this very strong message, is that when the bridegroom come or when Jesus come, there is no time to get ready. That's why it is imperative for us to be ready. And why I am speaking to Christians as well, I know a lot of time people say this message applies to non-Christians. Yes, it does. But it also applies to Christians, because there are Christians who can be lackadaisical and not ready. Yeah, they might go to church and read their Bible, etc., etc., and whatnot. But they might not be ready. And I don't have time to go into the details of that as to tell you why you can not be ready, or why you can, you know, be a Christian and not be ready, etc., etc. That is a whole discourse by itself. But I'm simply saying, Christian, you got to be ready. You cannot play the fool, and you cannot think that because you are going to church and you read your Bible and involve in church and stuff like that, that if Christ come and you're not ready, he's going to give you time to get ready. No, there will be no time. No time to get ready. You have to be ready. For the Bible says that this will happen in the twinkling of an eye. It means that fast, you know, that will happen. You won't have time to even pray a repentant prayer. You know, I'm sorry if I'm scaring some of you, but if I am, then I'm doing a good thing. And I hope that I scare you into being ready and into preparing yourself and every day make sure that you are ready, that if the Lord come now, you're ready to go. You see, some people, you know, because the coming of the Lord is promised and it has not happened yet, they think, well, you know, it wouldn't happen anytime soon. So if I do something wrong, you know, I still have time to repent and all of that, you know. And while that is a reality for our lives, and that does happen, the fact of the matter is that you never know when Christ will come. You never know at what moment he's going to put in his appearance. And that's why you've got to always be ready. Don't take chance. Live every day pleasing to the Lord and every day in accordance with God's word. Live every day as if he's coming now, so that when he comes, you don't have to go and get ready. You know, there are some people in life, they never ready. You say, okay, we are leaving home 8 o'clock. All right, and it means that they should get ready. And 8 o'clock come, and they're now looking for this, they're now looking for that, they're now getting dressed. Some of them haven't even gone to bed as yet, to shower, and stuff like that. And so, because of other people, you end up being late. But you see where the rapture is concerned? I wouldn't have to wait on anybody, because I'm not the one transporting anybody. When the rapture come and I'm ready, I'm gone. If you're not ready, well, too bad for you. It has no time. You know, there's this ad that comes on the radio, right? And it gets me every time that, you know, the husband calls out to the wife. I wouldn't call names and so on. But the husband calls out to the wife and say, let's go. And she says, I come in. I just am posting something here about homeowners insurance, etc., whatever, and so on. You know, I mean, is that the time you want to be posting when you should be going? And so a lot of people, when they should be ready, you know, that's the time they want to repent. They want to say a prayer. They want to read a psalm or whatever to get ready, to have time for that. You are either ready or not. You know, I mean, I do apologize. I didn't plan to spend all this time on this subject, but the more I talk, the more I feel the urgency of dealing with it, because a lot of people, you know, play the fool with their Christianity, and they think that, you know, this, because Jesus haven't come yet, you know, that he will not come soon. And, you know, they believe that we have time. I would like to believe that. I you know, but the reality is that while I hope that we have time to do X, Y, and Z, the reality is that Jesus can come at any time, and I have to be prepared. You know, some people struggle with the fact that if the Lord come now, they feel like they will lose out. And let me tell you, if that's your thinking, you're not ready. There is no earthly thing that you can possess that when Christ come and you have to leave it, that will be a loss. If you have to think about leaving your house and that's a loss, you are not ready for heaven or to spend eternity with God. You are not ready for the rapture. If you think that leaving X amount of money in the bank is a loss, you aren't ready. If you think that there's anything in this world that you have to leave, and you think of that as a loss, you are not ready. Because being ready means that you are ready to leave everything behind. you are ready to drop everything and go be with your Lord, because what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and then lose his soul? What profit is that? So if you look at any earthly thing and see that having to part with that is a loss, you are not ready. Jesus says that if you are not ready to forsake mother and father and husband and wife and children, and you are not ready to put all that aside for me, you are not ready. I love my wife. I love my children. I really, really do. But let me tell you, they cannot be compared to our Lord Jesus. Because, beloved, in eternity, they will not be the most important thing in my life. And I wish to God that my whole family makes it in the rapture. I really pray and hope to God that every man, every one of them, will be ready and living a life ready. But the sad reality is that I do not know. I just hope. But I don't know that for sure. And whether they make it or not, it is important that I make it. You see, I cannot make it for them. They have to make it on their own. I have taught them the scripture, I've taught them the word of God, and it is up to them now to live a life and have a personal relationship with our Lord. And let me tell you, that's the goal of every parent, is to bring your child to a place of a personal relationship with God. In other words, you carry them until they can fend for themselves. And when I say fend for themselves, I'm not talking about work and employment and finances and stuff. I'm not talking about that. I am talking about being able to have that personal relationship with the Lord. Because there are times when they thrive on your relationship. There were times when they depended on your relationship to God. Like I remember, you know, when my son one time was ill and you know, he was in severe pain, and when I ran to his bed, and you know, he said, "Daddy, pray for me, daddy." And you know, he depended on me. But now at an age, he can have that relationship with the Lord himself. And that is important. So, parents, you have to ensure that your children have that relationship with God. And so, when it comes to the rapture, we cannot ask God to hold on, you know, my daughter, my son or wife or husband or whatever. Lord, just give them a minute now. They're praying. They're not quite ready yet. You know, Lord, just for my sake, could you just give them a minute, please? Let me tell you, it have none of that. It have none of that. If we go back to the scripture, in Thessalonians, right? We would see where the scripture tells us, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead will rise first. And then we who are alive will be caught up to meet them together in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. So it at that point in time, it's all the Lord's doing. You and I have no time to intercede or any such thing. It's all the Lord's doing from then. He's in control. And that's why it is imperative that we be ready, we be prepared, so that if the Lord come, we are ready to go with him. All right. So I want to continue, you know, on that same trend, and I want to look at another scripture tonight. And that scripture is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 20. It says, "But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Now, for since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive." Now, I want to leave the scripture up for a little bit, and I want to look at the scripture, and let's see and try and get an understanding of what the scripture is saying. Okay, first it says, "Now Christ is risen from the dead. He became the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep." Now, fallen asleep, again, it means dead. So what is it saying? It is saying that Christ died and rose again, and so he has become the first fruits or the prototype of those who have already fallen asleep. Now, he goes on in the next verse to talk about what that is. "For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead." Now, what are we talking about? "For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive." Now, often when we talk about death, we talk about physical death. Somebody dies, you have to bury them or cremate them, etc. So often, we focus on that. But as we look into the scripture, this scripture is not talking about that death. Now, let me back up a little bit. Death, it means separation. To many people, death means ceasing to exist. And that must be taken in its context. You cease to exist in the body that you lived in. That's what that means. But it does not mean annihilation. It does not mean that you just go into nothingness. Death is a separation. The Bible says that for the body without the spirit is dead. What makes the body alive is the spirit man. So when physical death occurs, it is a separation of the body and the spirit. The spirit left the body. You all remember when Jesus hung on the cross and he died, you read in the scripture that he gave up the ghost. And when that happened, he was deemed dead. Now, the ghost that he gave up did not cease to exist, just did not exist in that body anymore. So there was a separation of spirit and body. And that's what death is. Death is really a separation. So, when God created Adam and Eve, and put them in the garden, he told Adam that you are free to eat of all the trees that bear fruit in the garden, except this one particular fruit or tree in the midst of the garden. This one particular tree, you are not to eat of it. For the day that you eat of it, you will die. All right? Now, that's what the scripture says. And we see that when Eve and Adam ate of the tree, they continued to live. They didn't fall dead on the earth. As a matter of fact, when they heard God coming, they went and hid themselves. Now, did God did not mean what he said? Was God trying to fool them? No. God meant every word that he said. He said, the day you eat, you will die. Now, yet they lived long after, hundreds of years after. Now, did God's word come true? Yes, God's word came true. They died. They did not die physically, meaning they didn't separate from their body, but they died spiritually. Now, this is a death that a lot of people don't look into. But in the moment that they disobeyed God and they sin against God, they were cut off from God. That connection that they had with God, they no longer had that. Time will not permit me to go into all the details, but they were spiritually alive or in tune with God. Many of the things God wanted them to do, he would have imparted that in their spirit. Didn't necessarily have to come and say to Adam and Eve, do this and do that and do the other, etc., etc. No, because of that spiritual connection that he had, I mean, think about Adam naming all the animals. Think about that. Adam didn't go to university. Adam didn't have an education. Adam, you know, but he was spiritually connected to God. And therefore, he possessed a wisdom and an ability to function above the smartest person today. See? So he had a connection with God, and sin caused him and his wife Eve to lose that connection. They became separated from God. So when they sin, they died spiritually. So Adam came to God came to Adam and called out to Adam. And what did Adam do? What did Adam and Eve do when God came to them? They did something that was unnatural. Something that they never did before. They ran and hid themselves. You see, because that connection that they had with God, they no longer had that. You see, the connection that they had to God, with God, would have embraced God coming. The Bible said God used to come down in the cool of the day and chat with Adam. we never read of Adam hiding himself. The presence of God was a normal thing for Adam. To feel the presence of God was natural. All of a sudden, the presence of God is an unnatural thing that he had to hide. Adam and Eve lost something when they sinned. They maybe didn't understand it. They didn't know it, but they lost something. They died just as God's word said. And so what was now natural have become unnatural. The Bible said they hid themselves. And when God asked why, they were afraid. They hid themselves. And he said, did you eat of the tree? And the blame game started there. Well, it's not me, it's my wife, etc., etc., etc. But they died spiritually. That connection that they have. So, hence the scripture now, it says that as in Adam, verse 22, as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. So what Adam had and lost, the Bible says that in Christ we can now have. I don't know if you understand the depth of this, but that connection or being in the presence of God that felt strange to Adam, that can now be normal to us. And beloved, let me tell you, when you are a Christian and you engage in that presence and you have that presence of God in you, when you don't feel that presence, you like fish out of water. As a child of God and being in Christ and having that blessing of the presence of God, if you don't have that, it is abnormal to not feel the presence of God. And so you have to ask yourself, where are you? This relationship with God, we have made it a lot about possessions and receiving from God and having things and having our requests known and being a beggar before God and all of that. And, you know, we have made this relationship, you know, to be that. But, you know, truth be told, is that if our relationship is focused on the presence of God, having material things will be normal. Those things will fall into place. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33 that seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all other things shall be added unto you. And let me tell you, if we focus on maintaining that relationship and dwelling in the presence of the Lord, we won't worry about things. Things will come. Jesus said, why worry about material things? Why worry about what you're going to eat and drink and put clothes you're going to put on and stuff like that? He said, the heathens worry about it. Let them worry about that. He said, because your heavenly Father takes care of you. So these things that we go after and we seek after and we pursue are really things God have for us. If we would pursue God rather than things, the things will come. He said, don't worry about what you're gonna eat. He said, look at the birds. They don't labor. They don't clock in and clock out. And, you know, yet every day they have food to eat. Every day. Not one sparrow falls to the ground without God's knowing. So the things that you are worried about and the things that you are pursuing, listen, those things are provided. The amount of time you spend in prayer for material possession, if you spend that time in prayer pursuing God and God's will and purpose on the earth, let me tell you, you will have all those things and much more that you haven't even thought of and haven't thought about asking God for. You will have all of that. God will cause it to come to you. If you take care of God's business, God will take care of yours. So, beloved, tonight, there is a blessing of being in Christ. And Christ came to make that possible. Because the Bible says, as in Adam all died, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. We have a privilege. Again, I think last week I said it. You know, we have the privilege to come in the presence of a holy God without guilt, sin, and condemnation. Jesus made that possible for us. Beloved, again, I want to encourage you, if you have not yet surrendered your life to Jesus, or if you have not yet committed to Him totally, tonight is a good night to do so. Bow your head with me tonight. Our Father, I thank you for your word, and I thank you for the blessings that you have provided in Christ. Lord, that blessing of having that relationship with you, being made alive to you, O God. Lord, tonight I pray, O God, for those that are far away from you, those that are playing the fool, as we say, one foot in church and one foot in the world. Lord, I pray, O God, for those that are halting between two opinions. I pray for those that are procrastinating and saying, not today, maybe tomorrow or someday I'll give my life. Lord, I pray for these people, O God. They don't understand the danger of dying without you or going into eternity without you. And so tonight, Father, I ask that you will draw them to you, O God. Draw them to a place of feeling guilty for their sins and feeling sorry for their sins. I pray that you will draw them to a place of surrender and commitment to you. I pray, O God, that you will save your people tonight. Oh, Holy Spirit, I ask that you touch them. I ask that you will, Lord, move upon their heart tonight. Oh, Father, in the name of Jesus, tonight, if you have not yet accepted Jesus Christ, or maybe you did, but you're playing the fool and not living according to God's standard, tonight I want you to pray this prayer with me. Say, Father, I come before you. And Lord, I know I'm not at the place that I should be. I know I have sinned many times and I've drifted away from you. And Lord, tonight, I surrender my life to you. I know that I've put off accepting you as Lord and Savior, but tonight, I realize what the pastor says is true. I realize what your word says is true. And Lord, I ask for your forgiveness. I ask, O God, that you will save me tonight so that when you come, I will be ready. And help me to live a life pleasing to you to the best of my ability. Lord, so that I'll be ready to go with you. Forgive me of my sins. I repent today. Wash and cleanse me thoroughly, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, thank you for making that commitment to the Lord. Thank you for surrendering to him. I encourage you to pray to him and ask him whenever there is a need in your life, or whether you need direction or you want to know more about God, just ask him. The Holy Spirit takes up residence in you, and you can always turn to him and depend on him. The Bible says he's going to lead and guide us and direct us. So I encourage you to develop a relationship with Almighty God. And don't put off what you can do today. Amen. Praise the Lord. Father, I just thank you for tonight, and I thank you for the message and the word that went out. I thank you for the viewers, and I thank you, oh God, and may your anointing flow with this view, with this broadcast, oh God. May it touch hearts, may it touch souls. Lord, that those who would view on Facebook or, Lord, even on YouTube, I ask, oh God, that you will draw your people, oh God, and minister to them. Father, as I give you praise. Lord, as I give you glory. And Lord, as I give you honor tonight, in Jesus' mighty and precious name. Amen. And amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, thank you for joining me. I trust that you have been blessed, and please share this with someone else. Encourage them to look at it. Go on YouTube, look at it. Go on Facebook, look at it. And, you know, be blessed tonight. Amen. Keep praying for me. I want to thank all of you for praying for me. Keep praying for me. And let us continue to do the work of the Lord. Amen. Praise God. This is Pastor Ralph Ramlochan of the House of Praise New Testament Church of God, located in La Fortune, Laramie, saying unto you that with Jesus, the sky is the limit. Be blessed and have a productive week ahead. God bless you.